Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Mas al khair, sumo sheikh. Well, I don't want actually to be a lecture, but we have to tell that this lecture will discuss music throughout history in the Arab world. We are going to concentrate on two main eras that witnessed a real renaissance of the Arabic music. The first one that reached its peak during the Abbasid era from the 8th till the 13th century, and the second one that reached its peak during the second half of the 19th century, started in Egypt and then continued in the entire Arab world. Before talking about theories, let's know first from where this tradition was established. Before Islam, there were only types of music that were popular and maybe even folkloric. They were reciting poetry, they were doing nights in the equivalent of bars today and nightclubs then. But we don't know exactly how was it. But what we know is a little bit before the Islam, Nadr ibn al-Harith went to Persia, the Persian emperor then, and he got some instruments and some music styles with him and mixed it with the music that existed in the Arab Peninsula then. These instruments, also we knew only that one of it was the barbat, which is the very grand father of the oud, which is now imprisoned in, yani it's only in Yemen. It's named after Gambus. You will see its picture later, not now. And from these instruments developed the oud, which was the instrument of the theories after. After Nadr ibn al-Harith, during the Umayyad era, Ibn Zurayh went to the churches of the Greek Orthodox then, and also went to the Roman Empire, the Constantinia, and to other parts of the Roman Empire then, and he got also some music styles from them. So by this melanging of these three tradition music types, we got the basic stone of the classical Arabic music that reached its peak in the first era of the Abbasid ruling to the area of Baghdad. The people who started theorizing to this music were mainly copying the ancient Greek books translating them to Arabic. And who did this work were Persians, actually. So we didn't have a real correct image to the music practice of the era, because of two reasons. The wusta, the middle finger, it was not the three quarters that's used in the tradition of the Arab music. It was half tone, in theory and three quarters on practice, till Mansur ibn Zalzal came during Harun Rashid's era, and he put this in a frit or in a distan in order for people to learn it with the other distance, not only to learn it by ear. We'll have a little bit of an evidence. This is the sababa. Okay, this is the first distance. Before it, below it, they call it the za'id. Okay, then this is the sababa, and this is the wusta for the theory, and this is the bunsur, and this is the khunsur. So he moved the distance to make. He made another wusta. So we have now two wustas, wusta al-force and wusta al-arab, or wusta zalzal. After this correction made by Mansur ibn Zalzal, we had a correct theory of the intervals of the Arabic music then. Passing time, we have some books that tells about the maqam, the modes, but not a true notation for the poetry that was sung. For example, we can know that some melodies that was sung by Ma'bad, he sang them in Bayati or in Sega or blah, blah, blah. But we do not know the real melody, what it was, because this is what Abu al-Faraj al-Asfahani told in his book. He only told about the mode. But it didn't carry the names that carried it today. He tells, for example, Sababa fi majra al-wusta. That's to say, sababa, we start with sababa, and then majra al-wusta, that's to say, we play the wusta after the sababa. Okay? And there are some for sababa fi majra al-bunsur, that's to say, or sometimes he tells mutlaq fi majra al-wusta, that's to say, for example. So this is how he defines modes. He defines them on the place on the oud. Not telling names for this. Also, there were no names for the degrees. Yaga, duga, siga, or dori, mi, fa, sol, or whatever. There were no names. Either, in fact, either in the east or in the west then. Later on, even in Farabi and Ibn Sina, they used the same thing, and they were telling nagham or shad. They were referring to maqam by nagham or shad. And then Safiuddin al-Urmawi came with a new system in the 13th century. He came with a system that provided more ease in pedagogy then. That's to say, he told about names of notes, yaga, duga, sega, charka, banchka, shishtka, haftga, which is yak, du, se, chahar, banch, chesh, haft, which is 1, 2, 3 in Persian, till 7, and ga, which means both mode and note, degree. So, we have yaga, Duga, Sega, Chaharka, Banjka, Sheshga, Haftga, and then again back to Yaga, but the higher Yaga. So this will form what they called Rast or Mustaqim, according to Ibn Sina. It's the same word. Rast is Mustaqim in Persian. Mustaqim, that means straight, or let us say major in English. Okay, so actually the true major in the Arab world was not the major of one half like the Western major. It was 1 3/4, 3/4, 1 1 3/4, 3/4 again, which is the Rast. So Safiuddin also did not only invent this system, he also invent a system of notation, of writing music. It was according to the alphabet. The first note is Aleph, the second note is Ba, the third note is Jim, the fourth note is Dal, blah 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 till the end. And he referred to time by the oud picking. For example, he tells A 2 or Aleph 2. So you know that you press, move your pick 2 times. Okay? So you know the tempo through the picking of the oud and the note through the letter that he writes. And by this he kept us some pieces of the 11th and 12th century from both instrumental and vocal things. Now we are going to perform a vocal one. It's told that it is from the 11th century and notated, written in Kitab al-Adwar لصفي الدين الأرموي around 1256, only 2 years before the fall of Baghdad in the hands of Alaco in 1258. So this one is Sawt على صبكم يا حاكمين ترفقوا, written down in his book, and we transcribed it. Dr. Nida Abu Murad transcribed it in the beginning of the 21st century, so for like 800 years before. So this is it, and feel them. It's like one melody that carried the two poetic lines, and it is only four notes only that are used in this melody. So listen.
يحاذر أن يشكو إليكم ويشفق.
one, we don't know if they had, bigger melodies. We don't know, but actually this, although it's very short, it took like 17 pages of the book, because, it's a very alphabetic system, as if he is writing lyrics, but he's trying to make it in an organized way as he can, so it took very much, I guess, effort from him, even. And then we have also an evidence that if they had instrumental music. How did they play it? How did they sing it? We don't know, really. We have a little bit of evidences of the techniques, but not that much. But we can tell easily that the oud took its modern shape in the ends of the 13th or the beginning of the 14th century. So let's listen to this instrumental one also written down in his book الرسالة الشرفية في الصناعة الموسيقية. It's a few years before his death. He died in 1294. And الشرفية means شرف الدولة, who was controlling Baghdad during the Mongolian ruling of Baghdad after the Abbasid era. So this is an instrumental work. Its name is طريقة في المستقيم. The other one was صوت على صبكم في النوروز. Now طريقة في المستقيم. مستقيم, that means rust. That means major, let's say. It's. And what we are going to note here is that he is using alterations on the mode, and he's using more notes, addings, and he asks the performer to improvise on this melody. And he gives a written example of the improvisation, and he asks the performer to improvise. Let's listen to it. And so, this is regarding the modal system. The rhythmic system, actually, they were referring to it in the beginning as the arud of Khalil ibn Ahmad, the wahur. For example, you have khafif al-ramal, thaqil al-ramal, al-ramal, that's to say the fast ramal and the slow ramal, etc., etc. The same names of the bahur, khafif al-mutaqarib, thaqil al-mutaqarib, and then they took out some names of the bahur, but the ramal exists after. It resisted even till the current. So we have خفيف الأول, خفيف الثاني, خفيف الثالث, and ثقيل الأول, ثقيل الثاني, ثقيل الثالث, and we had only the رمل, that we have خفيف الرمل and ثقيل الرمل. So now in the 14th century, the student of Safi al-Din al-Urmawi, his name is Qutb al-Din al-Shirazi. It's very clear that he is from Shiraz. He wrote a book and he developed this system, Risala fil Anghaam. He developed this system of Safi al-Din to write a melody that he told that it was composed by Safi al-Din al-Urmawi to the last Khalifa, al-Musta'asim. He composed it, he told, يَا مَلِيكًا بِهِ يَطِيبُ زَمَانِي دُمْ مَدَى الدَّهْرِ رَافِلًا فِي الْأَمَانِي لَا بَرِحْتَ الزَّمَانَ فِي ظِلِّ عَيْشِي آمِنًا مِنْ بَوَائِقِ الْحَدَثَانِي. And he tells that it was composed also, it was written, the lyrics was written, were written also by Safi al-Din al-Urmawi, not only the melody. And here he written it down, and it's a very long melody, so it seems that they had long melodies, but Safi al-Din was not able to write them down because it was very complicated writing his the way he was writing. So now this is qawl, and this is another form, not the sawt, as we told before. Qawl, and qawl is the real introduction to the basta that became after the muwashshah. Okay, so qawl. يَا مَلِيكًا بِهِ يَطِيبُ زَمَانِي, written down in the 14th century, but it is told that it is by Safi al-Din al-Urmawi. So. More complicated than the other two, and has many lots of ornamentations and lots of lots of alterations on the mode. It's قولي أمريكا في محير الحسيني. It also has a bit modern name, but of course, I mean, it couldn't be very rapidly improved, the music, I mean, in 20 years. It's impossible. I mean, it seems that Safiyuddin was not able, because he is the inventor of the system, so it wasn't that easy work for him to write very complicated stuff, so he chose to write only the easy things. So in fact, after the 14th century, and after the existence of the Ottoman Empire, the writing system did not exist that much in the Arab world, but it highly was existing in the Turkish Empire then, the Ottoman Empire, and the Persian with Abd al-Qadir al-Maraghi and many others, and with the Turkish with Ali Ifchi and Muhammad Kantamir and many other people who wrote books containing hundreds of works starting from the 14th till the 18th century. In the Arab world, however, people did not write. We don't have a real evidence of what was the music practice then, but we have some people that wrote descriptive things to modes. For example, like if he wants to sell, this is Maqam Hijaz, he tells only. This is the whole thing that was written. We have some books of the 14th and 15th century, such as Arisal al-Fathiyya, al-Lathiqi, al-Saydawi, al-Safadi, and also Shajar Zat al-Akmam, that is unknown. And this case remained after till the 19th century. We can, however, know from Turkish books that the Muwashah, for example, appeared in Halab in the 17th century. And there is a very big difference between the Muwashah as a literary form appeared in Spain in the 9th century, and the musical Muwashah appeared, the Muwashah as a music form appeared in Halab in the 17th century. The Muwashah of Halab, it maybe was named after the Muwashah, the literary Muwashah, because most of the lyrics of the Muwashahat were Muwashahat from the Muwashahat of Andalus and the Muwashahat of Ibn Sala' al-Mulk, who lived in Egypt in the 11th century and 12th century. I'm sorry. Who lived in the 12th century, and also, but we should take in account also that there are Muwashahat that were composed of poems, not Muwashahat as texts. So we should here know, and this is a very, very common mistake in the entire Arab world, that they think that the musical Muwashah is the same one that was performed in Spain, I don't know at what time, but this is not correct. Because the music in Spain during the Arab ruling was not written down except in the very final periods, and it was written down by European people, not by anyway. But the Muwashah of Halab of the 19th, of the 18th, of the 17th century, that started in the 17th century, has no relation at all except through lyrics with the Muwashah of Spain, through lyrics sometimes even, not all the times. So it seemed that there were forms that appeared during this era in the Arab and the Turkish area, that such as the Muwashah and the Basta and the Dor and instrumental stuff like the Sama'i and the Basharaf in Turkey that were following the Mevlevi order, Sufi order, and also some Turkish forms such as Ghazal and Sharke, blah, blah, blah. But we are now concerned with the Arabic music. Now we jump on to the 19th century. We'll find also two books in the beginning of the century that are carrying the same aspects of the earlier books, such as the book of Muhammad Shahabuddin, who writes the modes and some lyrics of songs, and referring to each song by the mode, like Abu al-Faraj al-Asfahani in the Abbasid era. And we also can find, we find another book written by Mikhail Masha'a, after. These are the two important, most important book of the books of the first half of the 19th century. And he writes down 95 melodies for 95 maqams, but also in a short ride. For example, he tells about the Nahaft al-Arab. Only. And he writes it in alphabet also, but very short phrases. In the second half of the 19th century, we have a real renaissance in of this music that started in Egypt with Abdul Hamouli and Muhammad Osman, who collected what should be collected as students from Egypt and Sham and even some parts of Turkey and some and of the Sufi music around the Arab world and many parts of the Arab world. They collected them and they memorized them very well, and then they tried to recreate from them another type of music. So we had many other types that appeared, either instrumental or vocal works. Now, it wasn't written down actually, but it was, with our good luck, transmitted to us through recordings that were recorded starting from the final part of the 19th century. Even Abdul Hamouli himself, he recorded. So we had new forms like the dor and the qasida, which is a mixing between the Sufi and the profane types of singing. And we have the very developed mawal, not the popular or the folkloric mawal. We had the very developed type of mawal. And then we had even some types of development for the muwashah. Well, we will start for the very known type then, which is muwashah. They started to add to the second, to the third part of it, some improvisation. The muwashah is composed from A, B, A. For example, we have Ya man laibat bihi shamulu ma altafa hadhihi shamail. This is A, and another A on another lyrics. نشوان يهزه دلاله كالغصن مع النسيم مائل. Okay, and the الترنم يا لو يا لا لو يا لا لو يا لا للي, etc. Okay, then we have the ميت خاني, the B, which is another melody and another lyrics. لا يمكنه الكلام لكن قد حمل طرفه رسائل. Here they added improvisation. Then they return back to A. ما ألطف عيشنا وأهنا والعاذل غائب وغافل. Okay, and they add very improv, and this is the first time you listen to it even, I know, but you will play it with me, so to improve, I mean to really try to prove the idea of improvisation. So let's listen to the muwashah, which is very simple, like I sang it, how it sang after this restoration that happened in the 19th century.
يا من لعبت به شمول ما ألطف هذه الشمائل يا من لعبت به شمول ما ألطف هذه الشمائل ما ألطف هذه الشمائل يا لو يا لا لا لو يا لا لا لو يا لا لا لي يا لا لي ويا لا لي ويا لا لي ويا لا لا ويا لا لا ويا لا لا ويا لا لا لي ما ألطف هذه الشمائل مشوان يهزه دلاله كالغصن مع النسيم مائل نشوان يهزه دلاله كالغصن مع النسيم مائل كالغصن مع النسيم مائل يا لو يا لا لا لو يا لا لا لو يا لا لا لي يا ويلالي 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 ويلالا 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 اللي كالغصن مع النسيم مائل. لا يمكنه الكلام لكن قد حمل طرفه رسائل. 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 قد حمل طرفه رسائل. يا لا ويا لا 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 ويا لا 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 ويا لا لا لي يا لا لا ويا لا لا ويا لا لا ويا لا لا ويا لا لا يا لا لا ويا لا لا لي. قد حمل طرفه رسائل. ما أطيب عيشنا وأهنا والعادل غائب وغافل. ما أطيب عيشنا وأهنا والعادل غائب وغافل. والعادل غائب وغافل. يا لا ويا لا 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 ويا لا 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 ويا لا لا لي يا لا لي ويا لا لي ويا لا لي ويا لا لا ويا لا لا ويا لا لا ويا لا لا لي. والعادل غائب وغافل.
So here, I mean, you can find that, how did they make it? They depended much on improvisation, even in the door, it's a form that was very simple, just a simple melody that repeats every now and then. Now they made it only one single time, and then you should improvise till the end of the piece. And we can find also a very great instrumental renaissance then. So let us listen, I mean, to some parts of some as an examples, that in order to show how improvisation really affected the I mean, not affected, was a main element of the Renaissance then. First of all, we'll start with Abdul Hamouli. This recording was recorded in a wax cylinder, so please tolerate with us a bit. It's very it has very much noise because of the recording. It's recording in the 19th century on a wax cylinder. So now, Abdul Hamouli, he was born in 1843, died in 1901. For history, I mean, okay. I mean, whoever after the thing is done wants to take it in an MP3 format is welcome with his USB key in order to take all the entire register and things from me. I'm fine. Now we move in to the second example. It's Dur. What did I do? Okay. Now this is a Dur that we are going to listen to it two times from the same singer. Okay, only the entry, to see how it is different from a recording to the other. This is the first recording. For gramophone record, 1908. The singer is Yusuf al-Mahalawi. He lived between 1850 and 1911. Now let's shift to the second recording. Recorded to Sama Al Muluk Record Company, owned by the same person in 1907, or 1907, 1908. But of course, because it's local company, so the disc making was much in a lower case than the one of England, like the previous one. Even in a fixed melody, you can easily note the difference. I mean, we have no time now for so much. Now we move on to another form. It's the mawal. Mawal was very developed. I mean, we will see now the mawal. One mawal also, the same mawal sung by two singers. The first is Abdelhay Hilmi, and the second is Said Safti. Now there is taqasim instrumental. I told you that the instruments now is playing, I mean then, played more important role than before, and also in an improvised way. Now let's skip this part. He sings it from Hijaz.
يا بسرة الملك من الله.
And this, if we can notice, it has no periodic rhythm. It has no rhythm. Periodic rhythm, I mean. It's totally improvised and with instrumental accompaniment. Now the same lyrics. In another mode. By Said Safti, also improvised. Same lyrics, but has now the Qasida. The Qasida was one of the main, very famous poems, the wanted forms in the entire Renaissance. Then the Qasida was also improvised, but not all the time like the Mawal. You can have same form like the Mawal, but with classic Arabic Fusha, and it's the Qasida Mursala. But we have the Qasida ala darb al wahda, the rhythmic Qasida is improvised, but in a periodic rhythm. Now let us listen to two recordings of the same qasida. وحقك أنت المنى والطلب وأنت المراد وأنت الأرب. We'll listen to it both by Sheikh Abu Ala Muhammad, once in 1912 and once in 1920. Well, I'll follow with you the rhythm, and you can follow with us also if you would like. Instrumental improvised accompaniment. فعل. Now, let's listen the same thing after 8 years. In another mode, he sang it to Bayati, now he is in Sega.
وحقك أنت المنى والصلب وأنت المعز وأنت الأرب.
It's a bit faster, maybe he was in a hurry.
ولي فيك يا هاجري صبوة.
So the difference is very, I mean, it wasn't, nothing was fixed. Now, even in instrumental works, the same case, we have a piece played also by the same player for two times, for example, but he never repeats himself. You can feel the piece, but you never will. It's not like the piano concerto of Rachmaninoff. You can listen to it now and after a year with another performance and can slightly hit the difference because the player is much clever. But here the matter is different. There is a total discrimination, link between the composer and the player himself. No discrimination. Okay. So the player is another composer for the composition itself. So let's listen. It's the very same piece of work, and the same players even. It's a matter of interpreting ta'wil, mystery, sirr, put here for the person to get the music from his heart, not only to be a machine that do what a composer wants to do. No, he has his own style. So, there was also some instrumental works that were types that were invented during this era, such as the tahmila, which is a dialogue between the instrument and the other ensemble. Yes. Here we go. Yeah, here's the dialogue. Question and answer. Question improvised, of course. The answer is fixed. Okay, and the final one is the taqseem. And the taqseem is a total improvised form. It can be non-beated and with beat. So I'll start alone, and then in a time that neither Just nor me knows when it's going to be improvised. So when it's going to be with beat. So I start alone, and then Just will follow me after I don't know when. Thank you. ensemble. It's totally improvised. So now before we end, before questions, I just want to show you some pictures throughout history. I wonder if you see. I don't. For me, I don't. I don't know if you can see. Anyway, this is the gamboos. The gamboos, the or the barbat. The okay. We'll see it in 15 minutes. Sorry. This is okay. I told you I don't see. So anyway, yeah, go. Well, this is the gamboos, the grandfather of the oud, and now this is a oud from the 18th century by Napoleon. And if you can notice, it's very similar like this one. It's even seven strings like this one. So who tells that I added the fifth string and I added the sixth and I added the seventh and I added, it's a matter of anyway. So this oud is out from the 18th century. And this then is a djank. It's like a harp. It was used and it was disappeared in the 19th century, but still a bit used in Turkey. It was one of the main instruments of the tradition. But it was disappeared from the Arab world. I really don't know why. I wish one day it returns. I'm looking forward for this day, and I'm trying. And this is the qanun, the old qanun that has no. He was to get another alteration for the mode. He just presses his finger here on the left of the instrument. Now he has keys in order to do this. Now this is the santur. It was used also in the entire area, but now it's very large, used in Iran, then Iraq and Turkey a bit, and it was disappeared from the other. And this is the kemanche, the grandfather of the violin. Yeah, and this is all. And if you have any questions, please tell me. I'm sorry if I got a little bit long. So yeah, my discussion.
Thank you, Mustafa, for this wonderful introduction. And then imagine, I think we only reached until about 1932 in the area that you covered, although maybe in a next event you might tell more about what happened after 1932, although you think partly that it was a decline. Okay, but we can discuss that in the next.
We can discuss, yeah. I mean, no, I mean, not even in 1930. If you'd like, it's with the same restoration or with the same Renaissance. Even the 19th century, you can have many military bands that were totally Occidental, derived from Occidental music or Western music. So I mean, it's not no. It's even with the Renaissance period, with the main. Trying to develop from inside, there were other people that tried to develop from outside, to import development from outside. Yeah, not even. It was this dominated after 1932 conference. Yes, but it started even before Abdul Hamoudi with Muhammad Ali in 1919 when he sent some musicians to France to learn music. Yeah.
1890.
Yeah.
Okay, but before I. Implicitly put the first question. Please, who from the audience would like? Are we going to bring a microphone? Yeah, there's a person here. Please, I would suggest
Hello?
To impossible.
I just have
your name.
A question, actually. Sometimes I know a friend of mine who was arguing that, Arabic music, there is nothing called Arabic music. It's actually Turkish music. In the sense that, I mean, all the Arabic music actually is coming from Turkish music, and since you skipped a little bit of the, you know, that the time during the Ottoman Empire, I'm a little bit curious of having you just tell us what you think about this.
Well, there are. Shall I answer or shall I wait for another one? Answer? Yeah, okay. So, listen, there were many musicians that traveled to the Asitana, the Bab al-Ali, Istanbul. There are many, I mean, more than, like, let us say, 10% of Ali Efci Bey during the 17th century writings composed by Mustafa Itri and Madani Muhammad Effendi, both of them are Arab. One of them is from Al-Madina Al-Munawwara, okay? And Dimitri Cantamirer also, he wrote, transcribed many works by Arabs. So actually, to tell you the truth, and I have now not to be very much subjective, I'm sorry to interfere with my opinion, and which I don't like in an introductory lecture at least, but I have to tell you that people who tell that music is Turkish are trying to defend who imported music from the West. Because from where do you think the Ottoman took the music from? From where did they get their music from? I mean, they came from China with a pentatonic scale. And you can go to some parts of Turkey and you will find a little bit of existing pentatonic scale there. So from where did they get their music? After they traveled, after they immigrated to this area, they took the music of the area. And like we say in Arabic, al-ayamu dawal, yani, sometimes it's here, sometimes it's there. But it is a shared tradition. It's a shared tradition. I mean, what's the difference? What is the entire difference between Arabic and Turkish and Persian music? You see? So who told that? I mean, they get the music from Turkey. They blah, blah. No. Theoretical-wise, somehow, yes, there are some Turkish influence on the Arabic theory. But practical-wise, no. It's a shared tradition. So the Arabic dialect is much different from the Turkish dialect. And by the way, what I want to tell you is who imported music from the West imported it from Turkey also. I mean, the maqams, the arzbar, busalik, and I don't know what, these complicated Turkish modes were not used during the Renaissance era. They were used during the 30s and the 40s by the same people that imported the silly harmony. Not the harmony, no, I mean it, the silly harmony, because they just, I mean, put line over line, and they think that they now are polyphonizing the music, and this is not correct. It's a matter of even the beauty of the harmony. It went because of the non studying of the Occidental, the Western, the classical Western system. So what I want to tell you is that who imported music from the West are the same who imported music from Turkey. Not the Arabic music is Turkish. No. I wish I convinced you, otherwise we can have more of a discussion later.
You are talking to the converts. Okay, that's fine.
What?
You were talking already to the converted, it was... Okay. Another question.
I'm not sure myself whether I'm understanding the difference between a mode and a maqam, and I just wondered how many modes are there, and exactly what is a maqam?
Maqam is mode, and mode is method. It's mode. It's method. And maqam is also method, way. So maqam has four characteristics to define, that are divided to two things, a scalaic modality, that's the scale of the maqam, and formulaic modality that has where the maqam is, where are the concentrated notes, and also what are the famous melodies on this maqam, and the ethos, the influence on the whether it is subjective or objective, whether it is melancholic singing, blah blah blah. Yeah? How does it affect the listener? How does it affect the listener? So, in the Arabic theory, not the Turkish one that is now that now is learned in the all in the entire Arabic academies, and it's alas falsely learned. So let's return to the Arabic theory. There are seven modes that they are named al-maqamat al-usul, al-maqamat al-usul, the main modes. They are divided to two parts: al-maqamat al-asila, the authentic modes, wal-maqamat al-muwallada, the derived modes or the generated modes. Al-maqamat al-asila, which is rast duga siga or yaga duga siga or rast bayati rahat arwah, which is rast plus rast, and then the duga or the bayati or the husaini, whatever name, or even you call it Abdus Salam, it's fine also. It's you who decide what name is. So it is, it's duga or bayati blinked in with duga, okay, and then siga or rahat arwah, it is siga linked with siga. And because the aspect of the main aspect and the branch aspect are the same, they were called al-maqamat al-asila, or the authentic modes. From them, four other modes were developed. From rast, the jaharka, or the baladi, developed, which is okay. And from bayati, the ashaq, or the nahawand, developed. And from duga also developed the saba, and from a mixing between duga and siga, it developed the hijaz. So these are the seven main modes. From these seven main modes, there are many branched modes that are countless, actually. But now, I checked this system throughout like 7 years of education with children, and I teach music EVE, music for formation musicale. Anyway, I teach it, and I found that teaching seven modes for a year, then starting to give the branches, are much effective and much convincing to the student than teaching him hundreds of modes in one shot. So he is, I don't want to learn Arabic music, I want to learn the blues. Or else teaching him major and minor, and he never gets the Arabic modes, except for example in the sixth year, where he is already has no knowledge about Arabic music. So he has an Arabic music from a Western point of view, so he is not that much different from a Western studier to an Arabic music. Yeah, so seven main modes and non-counted branched modes. I wish I answered.
Yeah, thank you. That's brilliant. Thank you.
Yes. Oh, there's already one. Okay.
I'm just wondering if you could tell us what was the origin of the Sama'i rhythm. If I've remembered right, that's the one in 10 counts. Because it was played in one of the examples, and it seems to me a very distinctly Arabic rhythm. I don't remember hearing it much at all in Turkish music. And it may be quite ancient from the examples you were giving.
Well, the Sama'i, every beat has its own wazn on the Buhur of the Buhur Khaliliyyah. So the Ma' is Mustaf'ilun Fa'ilun. Mustaf'ilun fa'ilun. This is the Sama'i beat. Okay, you can find it in the mutaqarib of the Khalili. Yeah. So this is the Sama'i rhythm. Okay. I don't know when it start. I don't know. I mean, of course, there is a person who would like to compose to put music for a poem that Mustaf'ilun fa'ilun. So he had the rhythm, but when? nobody knows. I myself have no clue. If anybody knows, it's fine. The Sama'i form is different from the Sama'i rhythm. There is a Sama'i form that's composed on the Sama'i rhythm. This was composed, first of all, as a vocal form in the Mevlevi order during the 15th century. Then it was it turned to be both vocal, Sas Sama'i Si, Sez Sama'i Si, which is instrumental Sama'i and vocal Sama'i in the 17th century. And then, bit by bit, the vocal Sama'i disappeared. So it became only instrumental.
Yeah. It's me again. Since I want this to be kind of informative for everybody, could you tell us a little bit about music in Al-Andalus? I mean, you know, Ziryab and so on.
Well, music in Andalus, you know, you mean during the Arabic ruling, don't you? Yeah, this is very tricky. I mean, you are talking about 800 years of two nations, sometimes in war and sometimes in peace. So you see what I mean? So systems, of course, were sometimes more Arabic, sometimes more Latin. There were also dialects, like the poetry that you see with Ibn Quzman. That's dialect, an Arabic dialect, Arabic nahw, Arabic grammar, but with many, many Latin words, many Spanish words. And there are many, many poems of these. We don't know how they were composed, actually. We have some notations from the late Arabic ruling of Spain and the very early 16th century music of Spain. We have many notations of them. Some of them is Arabic and some of them are Spanish, and they are very near to the medieval music of Europe. So it seems that in the final period of the Arabic ruling of Cordoba, when Cordoba resisted like 100 years and more as a single Arabic city in Spain, it seems that they were influenced a lot with the medieval music of Europe. So the final era was very much influenced, was highly influenced by the medieval European music. Now, you can have a link, but only a link, with the Arabic-Spanish music in Morocco, Tunisia, and Algeria. You can have an essence of how the nawba was formed. The nawba is the wasla, the suite, okay, of one mode. How was it formed? But of course, it's not these are not the main melodies that were played in Spain. Nobody can either assure or disassure. I mean, or agree or disagree. You cannot get sure at all whether these are the melodies or not, because they were not written down. But this, at least, the system is near to what was played in Spain during the Arabic ruling of Spain, and only in the Maghrib, Maghrib al-Arabi, the full Maghrib Arabi, not only, I mean, Morocco. So this is, you can find the link of what was played in Spain during this, during the Arabic ruling to the country. Yeah.
One more question there.
I would like to speak in Arabic first. شكراً على الأمسية الرائعة. وأود منك أن تعطينا المزيد عن الفرق بين الموشحات الأدبية في الأندلس والموشحات الغنائية التي تكلمت عنها. I would like to hear more about the difference between Andalusian موشحات and the musical موشحات in the East. Thank you.
Well, هل أجوب بالعربية أم بالإنجليزية؟ بالإنجليزية، نعم. So, the موشح as a literary form, it appeared in Spain during the 9th century. in Arabic. It was a poem that has many buhur in it, and many rhymes, many rhythms and many rhymes. Okay, many meters and many rhymes in it. Okay, it was composed by Madkhal, ثم أدوار, دور أول ودور ثاني ودور ثالث, ثم ختام, خرجة, شكرا شكرا شكرا, ثم خارجة, وهذه this خارجة is from the Khalilian Bahur. It should be from the Khalilian Bahur. Okay, the Muwashah, according to some writings in Spain, was composed musically in a nauba. That's to say, it was sung in an hour, the one Muwashah, because it's very long work. It's a very long piece of work. You can open some books of Muwashahat and you can find one Muwashah. It's more than 20 pages. I mean, the Muwashah is a long piece of work. So this is. They tell that a full nauba, a nauba in the Andalus, were to be composed from only one muwashah, lyrically speaking. Okay, the muwashah, the Halabi muwashah, is a totally musical form. Okay, appeared in Halab in the 17th century, final part of the 17th century, second half of the 17th century. It is developed from the basit. That is developed from the qawl, like Ya Malik and Biya Ghatibu Zamani, like we sang before. Okay, the qawl, it's, and the muwashah is A-A-B-A. You have a line of poetry in A and another line, repetition of the same melody, then a third line of poetry on another melody, then returning to the first melody in a fourth line of poetry. So the muwashahat only took like most in the longest muwashah 12 lines of poetry only. Some of the muwashahat were kharijat of the plural of kharija of Andalusian muwashahat, like walladhi askara min arfi lama kulla ka'sin tahtasihi wa habab. It is a kharija of muwashah by Ibn Zaydun al-Andalusi. It's not the full muwashah, it's only a kharija of muwashah. But also some muwashahat were composed of regular poetry of the era. It's not a rule for the musical muwashah to contain lyrics from a muwashah. No, some muwashahat has regular poetry. I mean, nazm. Is it clear?
One last question, or all questions answered? Okay, the answers are fixed, the questions are flexible, as you said. Okay.
So before you end, just before we end,
okay, yeah.
What we are trying to do now in Asil, and many people even before us, since maybe the 90s of the 20th century, is to return back to these roots, not to imitate it like parrots, no, to try to open another gate of development for this music, but from inside. What I'm trying to do is I'm trying to search in the music of Yemen, in the music of Gulf, in the music of Iraq, in the music even of Iran and Turkey, in order to see what fits to develop the Arabic classical tradition, but from inside. This is our equation, at least in Asil Ensemble. Yeah, and all what we play in the ensemble, I mean, you now listened me like singing so much from heritage, but in fact on stage we perform only new works, not heritage works. Yeah, so now it's Neil.
Okay. Yeah.